Hey y'all. Ready to do this again? I just want to cut straight to the chase for this one. There was definitely some kind of magic in the pop music water throughout 2021, and I know I'm not the first to say that. Even though I admittedly didn't pay much attention to the pop world for most of the year, I still found myself bopping to so much of its music. With 293 eligible top 40 hits, this was the most loaded year I've covered on this channel since 1975, and while it's tempting to assume that the larger quantity of songs overall could easily explain the surplus of truly quality music, I think it's more accurate to say that 2021 was just genuinely one of the good ones. Because I love so many of these songs, I had a really hard time whittling this down to a definitive top 10 for the year, so yeah, I guess take my top 10 with the tiniest grain of salt imaginable. This is just what feels right to me at the moment. Ask me again in about a week, a month, a year from now, and entries and positions could be wildly different. I guess just think of this more as a collection of top 40 hits I really loved throughout the year, with a vague top 10 thrown in for good measure. Just don't take it too seriously. It's just music after all. But I digress. Here are some honorable mentions. All the rumors are true, yeah. What you heard, that's true, yeah. I fuck him. One of the many hits from this year that definitely deserved better. But then again, I guess this year was pretty loaded. This is definitely one of Lizzo's best performances, and I love how she shoots down her weird haters with seemingly every line she spits. Also, the guitar is rad. It's brutal out here. As a 90s kid, I was bound to love this one. The main jagged guitar riff is so Riot Girl, and while it's admittedly replete with some of Olivia's clumsier lyrics, the sound definitely overtakes it all, and this was quite a jam for me this past year. That's my best friend. She a real bad bitch, drive her own car. She don't need no lift. This one grew on me a hell of a lot. It's just a really fun depiction of a couple gal pals night out, sorely needed in times like these. Saweetie is fierce as always, but Doja's got this one in the bag. I adore her flow on this part in particular. And she's so bad that I just can't take that bitch nowhere. It'll be a staple of my eventual going out playlist. I just know it. I'm Mr. Body Catcher, Slaughter Gang Soul Snatcher. Ain't no regular. I've said in the past that I'm a pretty big fan of both Savage Mode albums, and this is essentially just another Savage Mode cut, with a weird Drake verse thrown in for good measure. Project Pat is a welcome presence as well. He has an interesting old school hip hop vibes to him. Good stuff. That Silk Sonic album didn't really vibe with me as much as it did everyone else. I'd honestly rather just listen to some actual 70s Philly soul. Nonetheless, the production on this track mirrors that style to an absolute T, and these soaring melodies are just butter to the ears. Best of luck to these two newcomers. Wanna know what it's like? Baby, show me what it's like. I don't want to fight no tights. Planet Her was not as good as I would have liked. It had its highlights though, and Need to Know was one of my most revisited of the year. There's some weird eccentric energy from Doja throughout, and I'm a pretty big fan of this side of her, so that was quite a treat. Hoping for some more weird Doja in 2022. Some things just go better together. I've never been big on Luke Combs, but something's really clicked with me recently. His songwriting has become progressively more honest and gorgeous, which is a nice thing to witness. Better Together may not be one of his best offerings, but the sparse presentation and Combs' performance make for one of the most romantic songs of the year. Lovely stuff. And here's another grower. I pretty much tapped out about halfway through Donda. It's just not for me, bro. But the dismal dark gospel of Hurricane absolutely kills, and I found myself revisiting this atmosphere again and again this year. Kanye's done better, sure, but all things considered, this is the best possible outcome from this project, so I'll take it. I see you in 3D. The dawn is. Alright, we've got a lot to cover up ahead, so let's get started. These are my top 10 best hit songs of 2021. Dance with me under the diamonds. See me like breath in the cold. Alright, confession time. Up until pretty recently, this spot was gonna go to Seven Summers by Morgan Wallen. But I wonder when you're drinking if you find yourself thinking. This was one of my most revisited tracks of the last year. Those dreamy guitars and lilting melodies are instant serotonin to me, just the most perfect little country song. But yeah, you can probably guess why I decided to keep it off. Didn't seem worthwhile to separate the art from the artist when said artist has explicitly spread hateful rhetoric aimed at people I love. So instead I'll use this spot to praise another atmospheric piece of art centered around the bittersweet feelings of watching an ex-lover move on. Emphasis on the bitter. Car ride to Malibu, strawberry ice cream. I basically have nothing particularly unique to note on Olivia Rodrigo. Her emergence on the scene is a very welcome one, even if her lyrics could use a bit of growth from her very genuine teenage mindset, which is less a flaw and more a limitation, blah blah blah. But, well, let's just say I wasn't expecting to get a track so immediately impactful right off the block. I really love the way this song progresses, like how the opening verse displays various out-of-context snapshots of the relationship. Car ride to Malibu. Only for the kicker at the end of the verse to turn these euphoric moments on their head and transition to the song's core feelings. Yeah, but she's bragging to all her friends saying you're so unique. So when you gonna tell? The way that Olivia's voice soars at this bit, lightly de-escalating as an indication of her betrayal, is quite pretty. When she's with you, do you get deja vu when she's with you? Those high notes are also terrific. She's just a great singer in general. The music box instrumental is a nice touch, and I also love how the instrumentation gets progressively heavier as the song goes on, climaxing at that total fuzz fest in the bridge. Olivia sounds great here as well. The way she sings Strawberry Ice Cream is so much more scathing than how she did at the start. Just a really brilliantly structured song, and never not a total blast to listen to. As you could probably figure out by now, the bulk of my appreciation comes from the sound of this song, as there's genuinely nothing else quite like it on the charts right now. I can see how people would be turned off by these lyrics, but, well, these are also very clearly first heartbreak type emotions, and I think there should be room for these feelings in art, as messy as they can be. I also really dislike the comparisons made between this song and Want You Back by Cher Lloyd. Even if I do enjoy the latter more than most, Deja Vu is less catty than it is brutally, unattractively honest. Along with the fact that Lloyd's track was written with the big music industry machine in mind, while Rodrigo's was conceived much more organically. In any case, Olivia Rodrigo may have a ways to go before she's reached her full potential, but this is certainly a pleasant glimmer of things to come and is one hell of a composition to boot. And since this is probably the closest we'll get to Cruel Summer being the smash hit it deserves to be, I guess I'll settle for second best. Sleep with me here in the silence. Kiss me silver and gold. You say that I won't lose. I may have given Morgan Wallen the old boot for that last entry, but that doesn't mean that there weren't any big country hits to adequately represent the cream of the crop for this scene. For instance, a cold beer's got 12 ounces. A good truck's got maybe 300,000, yeah. As I mentioned earlier, it really took me a while to come around on Luke Combs. Not to say I disliked him, but let's just say that songs like Hurricane, One Number Away, and even When It Rains It Pours kind of cemented him into the monolith of the 100 other Nashville dudes flooding the scene. He, of course, soon distinguished himself from the bunch, particularly in the last couple years where I've come to play his most recent hits on the regular. At this point in time, it really feels like Forever After All is his masterpiece, and I'm not even sure how to describe why. The production isn't anything particularly exceptional, and those guitars and drums could be found in 100 other songs from any of the other Bretts and Bryans in country. Nor is the structure particularly different from those songs, typical verse-chorus-verse format with all the peaks and valleys in all the right places. It's just a typically clean, polished, smoothed-out mid-tempo country track at its core. At the same time though, I think that's exactly why it works so well. As I grow more and more invested in Luke Combs' career, I've also really warmed to his voice. He's got this southern twang that is ever so slightly raspier and more weathered than his contemporaries, and he absolutely kills it in Forever After All in particular. They say nothing lasts forever, but they ain't seen us together, or the way the moonlight dances in your eyes. I absolutely swoon over the way he draws out the word eyes in this chorus, not to mention that this line is just adorable. And that's probably the main source of its appeal here. It's simply a really touching love song from one person to his life partner. Combs goes through all the typical love song notions with his ruminating over what the concept of forever truly means in the context of romance. If the song were any more flourished and embellished, it might have come off too melodramatic and even disingenuous, but as it stands, there's just enough room for Combs to truly give his all, and boy, what a wonderful experience it is as a result. But you know what? There's one particular flourish I really love from the song, and that's this bit right here. Those de-escalating guitars are subtle, but so, so gorgeous. Serious chills with every time they're played. Followed by this line, of course. Just one of the most beautiful ways I've ever heard a song conclude itself all year long. And to think we could have had this become the first full-fledged country hit in 22 years. Oh well, can't win it all. Yeah, if you ever move on without me, I need to make sure you know that. Fuck it. Objectivity in music doesn't exist. I'm not your friend. With how hard I've been jamming to this since it dropped last November, I'm genuinely surprised I don't see more people going to bat for this. Okay, sure, this remains a bit of a flat follow-up to the obviously majestic output Billie Eilish had put out just a year prior, and yes, there are other songs on this very album that dwarf this song in comparison. But with all that said, this is still a pretty damn good song. It's kind of amusing to me how, when I first covered the song a year ago, I interpreted it as a kiss-off to the over-speculative media in regards to her image and reputation as an artist. While I think it's still true that the music video takes aim at the then-current obsession with her body weight, and does so quite cleverly, I think that it's even more important to note how the song is recontextualized through its placement in Happier Than Ever. Try not to abuse your power. After the utterly heartbreaking Your Power, Billie transitions to NDA, a darker, gloomier number that shines a light on the internal peril Billie had experienced having become famous at a very young age, taking particular note at others' constant surveillance and how she struggled in relationships as a result. And then we get this transition. Your friend. I don't know about y'all, but this smooth as hell transition elevated this song so much more for me.
Stop. What the hell are you talking about?
There's just so much for me to love here, and this was definitely one of my most replayed hits from last year. This song takes Billie on a more pop-driven direction, but with the same erratic patchwork structure that Finneas implements in all their best songs. That buzzing bass is so great, especially placed alongside the little synthesized string notes and hand claps in the chorus. I also love the deep droning voice placed along Billie's vocals. I just think that's really cool. Eilish, of course, is really great, with their signature breathy delivery just a little stiffer than normal, instilling a firm sense of bossy confidence through the song's whole. While this can still apply as a giant middle finger to the media, considering that Happier Than Ever was released as a reaction to her running free from a manipulative, abusive ex, it also concurrently serves as a victory lap of sorts, having finally been freed of this situation. It's more of a cathartic song than I think I could have ever anticipated it being, and now it's one of my own personal fuck you songs as a result. Not to mention that the placement of the song within Happier Than Ever would set the stage for the emotional swell that would occur through the rest of the album. But we'll get to that part later. You know, as much as I love analyzing songs and going into long-winded explanations as to why X lyrics and Y compositions work within a larger picture, sometimes it's nice to admit that a song just slaps really hard. And I'll take any excuse to put this guy on my list.
Baby, ya yo me enteré, se nota cuando me ve, ahí donde no has llegado, sabes que yo...
Okay, I just want to get this little bit of negativity out of the way.
Oh man, look at my life.
I have epilepsy. I was diagnosed at 16, and while I have it pretty under control these days, I still find certain imagery such as flashing lights, strobe lights, and erratic colorful editing to be a bit of a trigger for me. I probably won't have a full-blown seizure from interacting with such imagery, but they usually tire out my brain. It can cause headaches and sometimes even blurry vision. This is all to say that I really wish that this song, one of my favorites of the whole year, didn't implement these strobe lights in its video so prominently. As a matter of fact, I wish that this trend would just stop in general. It's so aesthetically tired and just plain annoying for those of us it affects the most. Just my bit of soapboxing for the video. But anyway, yeah, this song goes hard as fuck. It's basically been a staple of my nighttime, would be preparing for a night out in normal times playlist for essentially the whole year, and it just hits the spot every single time. I mean, the sound of the track alone is just really, really cool. More open, ambient-sounding music has been making a rise in the mainstream lately, and there's something oddly comforting about the spacious, droney atmosphere of Dakiti. The ebbs and flows of the song are pretty standard, but the catchiness of its melody makes it stand out in all the right ways. It's invigorating, yet so, so chill, and hits the spot every time. And it's amazing that this hits so many marks for me, considering that the translated lyrics don't amount to much more than typical party flexing and such. But I think so much of what I love about this song extends beyond the language barrier. It's also helpful that Bad Bunny has been one of the more interesting reggaeton artists out as of late, deviating from his peers by keeping in touch with this feminine side and upkeeping this image of a ladies' man without being explicitly misogynistic. Bringing this energy to the table results in party music that is genuinely so great and uplifting, though never overtly saccharine nor overflowing with obnoxious machismo. It's honestly really refreshing, and listening to this never ever gets old. At the end of the day though, it's all about that chorus melody. Essentially, this is one of my favorite choruses of the entire year. The way the bass hits at that drop is just heavenly, and that final chorus where Bad Bunny and Jay Cortez sing in unison is the most euphoric thing ever. Amazing, amazing chill. It almost makes up for Zafaera and La Canción not being super big hits here in the States. Almost. I genuinely thought this would be much higher on the list considering how much I've been eating it up these past few months. But what can I say? The year was just that good. Baby bet, ay, couple X, ay, couple Grammys on him, couple Plex, ay. Watching the lead up to Lil Nas X dropping his album this year was one hell of a wild ride. I mean, if you were there too, you know. And this lead-in was so brilliantly capped off by his pop-trap masterwork Industry Baby, which takes a stab at the many critics who wrote him off as a one-hit wonder in the wake of his Old Town Road fame. So basically everything that could possibly be said about this track has been said. But I'll try to give my own take. This is so amazingly triumphant, from the escalating horns in the backing instrumental to the exciting flow and energy to the bar spit by Nas. I'm not joking when I say that this hook melody was stuck in my head for hours after listen number one. It's just that catchy. In general though, I've been really loving watching Nas come into his own these past few years. He's really developed quite a lot as an artist, and his underdog takeover of the whole scene has been very satisfying, especially because I think he's genuinely so, so talented. His performance on Industry Baby is surely one of his most shining moments. He just exudes absolute confidence while also never taking himself quite so seriously. I mean, with lyrics such as these, how could you? Oh yeah, there's the other guy too. My track record so clean, they couldn't wait to just bash me. I'm
must be getting too fleshy.
I gotta admit, there's something oddly mesmerizing about Jack Harlow's verse here. I couldn't really place it for the longest time, and then one day it finally hit me. It's just Jack Harlow. It's really taken a long time to warm up to him, but it's clear now that his uniquely chill yet clean flow is such a breath of fresh air these days. He brings some nice energy to the track, and his bridge helps the song shine even further.
Got these pussies walking around like they ain't losers.
I told you long ago on the road.
I used to have concerns over whether Lil Nas X could hold up a track on his own without the use of a guest feature, and while these concerns have been thrown out the window this past year, I also think that his formula is one that greatly benefits from a guest feature that ties everything together. I think that Harlow does exactly this for Industry Baby, and the team up here makes for such a fun, forward-thinking bit of pop trap. I love it a lot. Seems like victory laps have been a bit of a theme in 2021. Awesome. Now before we move on even further, here are a few more honorable mentions.
Ooh, I love it when you do it like that, and when you're close up, give me the shivers.
Ed Sheeran overwhelmingly misses for me, but he still occasionally hits, and this one is such a hit. I love the jumpy instrumental in the verses, and that chorus is so catchy. It's probably got stuck in my head more often than any other song this year, so yeah, kudos to Ed.
Can you stay up all night? All night. Fuck me to the daylight.
I prefer Ariana's beltier tunes, but this is still cute and hot and stuff. I will say that her coy sense of humor did grate on me a bit the longer the song stayed in rotation, but that's only a minor side effect. It's still uniquely adorable, I think. Sad to see that this song will very likely be caught between years because this is such a cool sound, coming from someone who usually turns their nose at EDM. The rest of the song doesn't quite stand up to the first minute and a half, but boy, what a banger those 90 seconds are.
I've been lit since brunch, that shit. Order 42 for the table, let's pop shit. Missionaire or Nike style on my top shit.
True that this song isn't quite as majestic as that music video. Nonetheless, this is Meg in full steamroller effect, spinning bars like it's nobody's business as a not-so-gentle reminder that she is, yes, still number one in her game. Always one hell of a fun listening experience. As is this. Listen, I know that that uber repetitive hook ain't for everyone, but after my umpteenth listen, I frankly couldn't imagine the song without it. It also has some of the best lines Meg ever recorded, so that's also a plus. I also get why people don't like this, but Megan sells it, so I don't care. That's definitely not a baby sound in the background though, not even a little bit. Y'all are weird for that. This works so well as my go-to pick-me-up banger of the year. It's a pretty standard Cardi bop at its core, but I just love listening to her rap, and this beat is also just hype as hell. I don't know what any of those words mean, but I still love it. I'm so sad that this one ended up missing the cut, especially after I've been vibing with it for like 2 years. I just love the creepy crawling feeling of that instrumental, and Doja's multiple personalities fit the mood to a T. Even to this day, it hasn't gotten old. Boy, is she great. Okay, time for number 5 now.
Forever's not enough time to love you.
Okay, I promise I'll stop making such a big deal about my age eventually, but I just want to say that it's been really interesting seeing all the weird and wacky trends that kids a decade or more younger than me have been picking up. TikTok has, of course, been a big source of these, and while there's certainly a number of questionable elements about this social media platform, I think its contribution to the pop music scene specifically has been a net positive overall. I mean, it couldn't possibly be that bad if it made this song a hit.
Can't
believe, can't So I feel very fortunate to be able to state that I've been on the Kelly Uchis train since 2018, around the time of her sophomore album Isolation. I've been absolutely mesmerized by her style from the very first listen. Her music always has this very seductive sway to it and is chill as fuck. Seriously, no one else does R&B like she does. And while overall I think her latest record hits fewer highs than the previous one, Telepatía nonetheless gives me absolutely everything I could ever want from a smooth Kelly cut. This is just an absolute dream of a song. That main synthesizer riff is scratchy but never aggressive, and so brilliantly undercut by floatier notes in the verses, as well as that subtle guitar sample in the chorus. But the real star of the show is, of course, Kelly Uchis herself. There's such a profound emotional pull to her vocals, with a deep longing seemingly dripping off every word she sings. All of this just feels so fluid and warm, all encompassed with intense lovey-dovey feelings while also remaining so effortlessly chill. It might seem rather unremarkable to some, apart from this temperate aesthetic it so vividly expresses, but it might also be the one song of this entire list I couldn't imagine changing in any which way. It's just perfect, I guess. Inadvertently though, this song has really helped me get more in touch with my Latin side, which really can't be said for any other hit song this year. I even memorized all the Spanish lyrics for the sole purpose of being able to sing along with each listen. Not exactly the most revolutionary thing in the world, sure, but I'm always looking for more excuses to expand on my microfluency. So yeah, I'll take what I can get. Overall, it's abundantly clear that Kelly Uchis has been an absolute blessing to my and everyone else's eardrums. Even if this ends up being the only big hit of her career, boy, what a hit it was. So it has now been a full year since I gave this song its very first listen, and well, if you would have told the Lizette back then that this song would have not only ended up on the best list, but ended up this high, I don't think they would have believed you. And yet, here we are.
I got my driver's license last week, just like we always talked about.
But it's not like I automatically wrote off this song from the first listen, certainly not. We can call it a symptom of buying too much into the overwhelming hype at the time, but, well, I think I might have just expected something more, or at least something different. The stripped backness of this song doesn't leave very much to the imagination, nor do these lyrics that feel almost torn straight from teenage Olivia's diary. But suburban teen heartbreak is still heartbreak after all, and after a few more listens and a few months' time, yeah, this is a really stunning, devastating debut. This is another song that everyone and their mothers have analyzed to high heaven, but one thing I would like to note about this is that, like Deja Vu, this song has a really cool sonic structure. Led by that familiar turn signal metronome, the song then builds off the emotional swell of the lyrics, upping the intensity until that famous bridge pops in. The song is so involved in the own personal distress at its lyrics, it's just fascinating. Truly nothing else matters here except Rodrigo's bruised and tattered emotions. But yeah, obviously, it's all about the bridge. I can understand how that bridge may seem overwrought for some, but it has never failed to give me the absolute chills. It's almost apocalyptic in its intense melodrama, especially when Olivia frustratingly spits out that one line. You know the one. I also have to mention that for as young as she is an excellent vocalist and performer. This moment is just eyes closed, whole world closed off melancholy, and I'm living for it. There's another thing I really love about both this song and Deja Vu, and that's how they both end. Deja Vu closes off with that bridge tapering into a fuzzy instrumental, while Driver's License has Olivia professing her feelings with one final chorus, much sparser in sound and somehow more desperate than before.
I just can't imagine how you could be so okay now that I'm gone.
The result is an unfinished introspection on this heartache. There's no grand conclusion to reach from her feelings of sadness and betrayal, only the sadness and betrayal itself. And I think that's kind of beautiful because these are such hard lessons to learn when you're so young and enduring your first breakup. In my opinion, I think Rodrigo portrays them beautifully. And I can't wait to see where she goes from here.
You said forever, now I drive alone past your street.
It's been a really exciting era for new artists these past few years. A lot of my favorite pop songs lately have come from really young, fresh-faced performers who have leagues of potential straight ahead of them. Sometimes, however, the best songs come from those already accomplished artists who have proved time and time again that they know how to churn out a good, truly compelling work of art. Really happy to extend my praises to this performer once again.
It's like you got superpowers. Turn my minutes into hours.
So, I really liked Positions. I understand that it's far from a highlight of her career, but it's also clear that Ariana Grande's reached a point where she doesn't need to try too hard to win listeners over and can just have fun. With that said, the album still has its high points, and I still return to tracks like My Hair, Love Language, and of course, 3435 from time to time. But no track has been nearly as impactful as the album's closer, which I think is also one of Ariana's most shining moments of her entire career. Contrary to the rest of the record, which goes in a number of different styles and directions, the sound of the song is much more calm and stripped back, with soft keys slightly punctuating the front and center performance that is Ariana herself. And like, we all know she can sing, there's no surprise here. But it's really remarkable how evident this is, even as she sings in her really soft, wispy register for most of the song. Her vocal control throughout the song is just remarkable. Also true of those multi-tracked backup vocals during the chorus.
I wanna trust me,
trust me.
The way that you trust me.
This is such a great example of an artist using her voice as an instrument, and it comes off so beautifully. Lyrically, this is one of her most compelling songs, as it describes how her own shortcomings and anxieties are cushioned by her partner's love for her. This isn't the first time she's discussed her anxieties through her music, though I think that the message at the core here is particularly touching. For many people, one of the hardest parts of being in a relationship, as wonderful as said relationship may be, is nonetheless feeling like they are unworthy of being loved. This could be due to a variety of factors, be it anxiety, depression, trauma, or any number of other past experiences that could cause such hesitancy. And if I may be blunt for a moment, empty motivational phrases like, you must love yourself before others can, are bullshit, because loving oneself is such an arduous task, one that can take an entire lifetime to accomplish. And I believe that everyone is worthy of being loved, regardless of their own self-esteem. The way that Ariana lays these honest anxieties so bare is absolutely commendable and makes for quite the enthralling listening experience. Also, there's this.
I wanna love.
One of the best that ever was, if I'm being honest. God, this is good.
When I'm away from you, I'm happier than ever.
It feels like so long ago that I was embarking on this new semi-underground artist named Billie Eilish through her Don't Smile At Me EP. Listening to this, there wasn't too much that really stood out, but at the same time it was abundantly clear that the image she gave off was really unique and interesting, and there was so much room for something greater to truly shine from this. Fast forward a few years, and she's now one of the most famous musicians in the world, with a number of terrific material under her belt, and a much more realized artistic vision widely commended by many. But it's also evidence, if only from this song alone, that she's endured quite a lot of pain to get to this point.
Wish I could explain it better.
In the first half of the song, amidst delicate, barely there guitar strums, Billie harkens back to the days when she was still in the midst of her past relationship. Her performance is just as paper thin as the instrumentation, and she repeatedly doubts herself and her capabilities.
Give me day or two to think of something clever.
But as many of y'all know by now, the most interesting part of the song is what comes next.
You call me again, drunken.
As the song builds up momentum, the acoustic guitars turn electric, and Billie shifts to a specific instance in their relationship wherein her trust was betrayed by her partner. The way she tells this part makes it seem like it was the final straw of this failed relationship.
Cause you only listen to your fucking friends. I don't relate to you.
This realization then shifts to surely the most cathartic moment of the entire song, and possibly the entire year.
And that I'm toxic, but I was in one minute and never told anyone anything.
This moment is a lot of things. It's huge and liberating in its sound, from the uber blown out instrumental to Eilish's lyrics, now a more direct condemnation of her ex's shortcomings and vocalization of her annoyance of such. At the same time though, there's so much sadness and anger behind Billie's performance. This is clearly someone who has been hurt in ways only those with similar experiences could truly understand. The way she sings "Cause I Was a Kid" is absolutely devastating, almost as if she's mourning her youth and the hours, days, months that were lost as a result of the constant pain and worry brought on by this other person, someone she loved and trusted to protect her. The context of this song, of course, is the real punch in the gut. As someone who is in a several years long relationship with someone much older than me, I completely empathize with the feelings of powerlessness in the midst of something you couldn't possibly completely understand at the time, as well as the feeling that a certain part of you is forever missing upon the relationship's end, no matter how over it you may feel months and even years later. This emptiness is very apparent in Happier Than Ever, but what Eilish does with these feelings is absolutely remarkable.
Just fucking
the way the track closes off is one of the most amazing things. The trauma from this experience is so apparent through the boisterous wall of sound and Billie's pained screams. At the same time though, it also feels like her taking back her agency, building up the strength to take what she has endured and create something new from it. Of course, this is just one person's interpretation. But this is also me wishing the very best for her and her healing from this point forward. Truly remarkable stuff. And now, before we get to my number one song of the year, let's close off the rest of these honorable mentions.
I get like this every time.
In a year not so stacked, I'm certain this would make my top 10. Giveon's performance so effectively rips my heart out of my chest with each and every listen. Seriously, what an accomplishment of a track.
Remember every
another cut from Montero that I felt needed to be much bigger. Nas takes on this pop-punk vibe with such comfortability, and I especially love his white girl rap in the second verse.
Like, tell me that's life when I'm stressing at night. Be like,
my ex-man brought his new girlfriend. She's like,
absolute perfection from this year's king.
That's what I fucking want.
Caught a vibe. Yeah. Baby, are you coming for the ride?
I didn't expect this to get very far, but it's nice that this was successful at all. Just a really nice and breezy duet with a clean indie vibe that we really don't see too much of nowadays. It's nice having Willow Smith making waves in her own way. Quick, let's make Transparent Soul a hit too. Sure, I always joke about this being the Jonas Brothers version of Last Christmas, Circles, Save Your Tears, etc. That's only because I'm in utter crippling denial over how much this completely tears me apart with every listen. We are truly in a marshmallow era. This is a third straight best of current year list where I featured After Hours era The Weeknd, and I think that's really funny. Anyway, this track is good, Ariana jumps on, and it still stays good. Can't say too much else here. So I guess it's officially too late to campaign a push for Hardest to Love. Okay.
Fly away with me.
This has been one of the most recent palpable examples of how overplay can kill my interest for a song. Nonetheless, I just know that when I return to this one in a few months or so, it will absolutely kill as much as it did that very first listen. Still one of Dua Lipa's finest works. Let it be known that I've been on board with this song since like a year prior to its official release. I know that the marketing for this single was a big old dumpster fire, but now that that's all died down, it's nice to be able to appreciate this song again. Amazing flamenco flavor and unabashed queerness. Love, love.
Okay, let's try. It don't matter to me wherever we are, but I wanna be.
I can imagine this being the song that will flood me with bittersweet flashbacks in like 5 years or so. It's really nice that Chris Stapleton has been getting more attention these days, and considering how anxiety-ridden these past couple years have been, I'm also really glad that this was a song to do it. Just an absolute gem of a ballad. It's done a lot of good for me this past year, as I'm sure it's done for many others. Number one time. Remember tranquility? You know, the concept. Oxford Dictionary describes it as the quality or state of being calm. Calm. There's another word. When was the last time you felt truly calm, unbothered, at ease with yourself and content with the world around you? When was the last time you just sat, closed your eyes, and thought about nothing at all? As a queer, middle-class female presenting millennial with a neurological disability and limited income, tranquility doesn't come around too often for me anymore. So these days, I'll take where I can get it. This song came into existence just when I needed it most, right when it was really starting to sink in that the state of things wasn't something that would go away so quickly. A new normal, if you will. Amidst the chaos and calamity, despair and bleakness, came this song that would come to be a constant source of comfort for me throughout the rest of the year. It's just so refreshing, so unique from so much of the cluttered fare from a contemporary pop scene. And most importantly, it invites us to imagine a future where there are indeed good days. SZA sounds great here, but that's nothing new. She's always sounded great. Her performance here is as beautiful as it is restrained, giving room for the hazier, more atmospheric elements of the production to shine. She's joined by the uncredited vocals of Jacob Collier, who is someone I honestly don't know much about. Nonetheless, his contributions here are absolutely essential, with his deep, ghostly backing vocals balancing the sweet earthiness of the bulk of the track. But yeah, overall, it's all about SZA. Just the way she hovers around the word day has been a huge source of joy for me this year. Also, the biblical references are pretty great. Something about how she describes this biblical figure as having lost his shit just makes me smile for some reason. It's so silly. There have been a handful of popular songs recently that seem positioned to instill a sense of hope and positivity in its listeners, working as a response to the fraught social climate of the day, be it implicit or explicit. In my opinion, though, no song presents this optimism quite as realistically as Good Days.
Just pretend shit never happened. Half of us laying waste of our youth is in the present.
The instrumentation is lush and earthy, and SZA just sounds gorgeous. But there's also a sense of instability to the track, like something dark creeping just below the surface. And such is life. As much good days as there are to be had, bad days will always be just around the corner. But this also means that those bad days themselves will soon come to an end as well. I've slowly come to the realization that I don't really have days where I'm truly happy. I don't know if this is more of a symptom of getting older than it is of depression, but I'm sure both of these factors work hand in hand to some degree. In any case, a recent goal I've given for myself is to find my own sense of peace and tranquility wherever I can find it. I don't know if true, complete happiness is something that's in the cards for me, but if I can at least find a source of escape from my own anxieties, my own personal Eden, if you will, that may be just enough for me. Or maybe not. I'll just have to wait and see. In the meantime, I'll just keep listening to this song some more. Good Days by SZA. Most positively, the best hit song of 2021.
I just wanna slide. Parties in the sky like it's 2055. She said, boy, you nice. Boy, you nice. Heart cold like some water and some ice.